with Israel and rescue. Moses said to Joshua, choose some men for us and go out. Fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the staff of God in my hand. So Joshua did as Moses told him and fought with Amalek while Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. Whenever Moses held up his hand, Israel prevailed. And whenever his hand lowered, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands grew weary. So they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side and one on the other. So his hands were steady until sunset. And Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the sword. God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to come to the table as we break open the bread of life. Thank you, God, that as we receive this word, we receive this bread, that we also receive the understanding and the courage to move forward. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, God. Thank you so much for being our strength and our Redeemer. It's in your name that we pray, give thanks, and believe to be so. Amen. There are three parts to the text for today that I would like to unpack with you. Two of them are quite obvious in verse 11 and verse 12 concerning Moses' arms being up and then when Moses' arms became tired. But the third one requires for us to think beyond the words on the page. Whenever Moses held up his staff or his hands, Israel prevailed. And whenever his arms and or the staff came down, for whatever reason, the Amalekites prevailed. So I take a moment to be transparently honest with you and say that when I thought about Moses' arms going up and Moses' arms coming down, I thought a little bit more about why his arms were staying from there. So I said to myself, well, what if his arms came down kind of because he had an itch? Or what if his arms came down because there was a sandfly that got in the way? Or what if his arms came down because a child ran up behind him and started pulling on his robe? That would be an interesting reason for those arms to come down and for the Amalekites to prevail. But nevertheless, it wasn't just about Moses' arms or the staff. Before he ever went to the top of the hill with Aaron and Hur, he told Joshua to choose some men to fight, we see in verse 9. Moses didn't choose the men, Joshua did. Joshua allowed this to be a place of delegation, and Moses allowed this to be a place of delegation, and then Joshua followed it up with due diligence. It was after Joshua had the men that Moses went to the top of the hill. And even more, the chosen men had to do their part in the battle, not only with fighting, but also by staying aware of their surroundings and staying attentive to Joshua's commands. Here we see a plan successfully worked because hearts of commitment and hands of action were aligned, moving in forward motion. They all worked together, aside from Moses raising his arms. But if there was no willingness and no cohesiveness among the men on the battlefield, I don't think it would matter if Moses held his arms up or not. This is where that thinking beyond the words of the page comes into play. A lack of cohesiveness and a lack of willingness would have led to a holdup in the battle, if you will. A holdup in what we get to the end to find to be victory. A holdup in forward motion if the men of the battlefield allow themselves to be held up with minute matters, such as who would carry the water and who's going to tend to the people that with our hearts and hands aligned. And I believe that we all want to be able to prevail with visible church growth and community engagement. Yet I pose the question, are all of our hearts and hands ready to move forward? Ready to move beyond Sunday sermon? Ready to move forward to the point of taking action? Will you do me a favor and ask the person next to you, are you ready? And then can you ask that question to yourself and say, am I ready? And what's your answer? Not necessarily to me, but to yourself, not the expected answer, but the answer of your heart. Do you believe that we're ready? And if not, can we get ready? If Moses didn't believe that Israel was capable of fighting and winning the battle, I believe that he would have sent Joshua out to choose men to fight. And if Moses didn't believe that stationing himself on that hill with a staff in his hand would serve a purpose for helping Israel men, I don't believe he would have done that either. What I do believe is in us. I believe that we have what it takes to do some shaking and some shifting for the sake of visible church growth and community engagement. I believe that we can come together as the co-creators we are with intentionality and shake and shift on purpose. Moses didn't do it on his own, and he couldn't have. Not only did he have the help of Jehovah Nisi, God our banner, with him, he also had Joshua and the men on the battlefield. So while Moses was standing on the hill doing his part, Joshua and the men were in the battlefield doing their part. But even more, when Moses' arms began to get tired, we see Aaron and Hur step up into the scene. And when his physical body began to get tired, and his arms began to get heavy and weak, Aaron and Hur came on side to side to help him. They were in it together. They didn't allow themselves to be held up, with the question of who's going to hold up which side. And they didn't allow themselves to be held up with the question of how long do we have to hold up his arms. They were in it for the long haul. They were literally in it to win it. They were willing to be there with and for Moses for as long as the battle carried on. Not only was Moses being supported by them, they were also supporting Joshua and the men on the battlefield. The word support in Hebrew translates to mean tamak, T-A-M-A-K, which means to hold up. The support Aaron and Hur provided Moses was in direct connection with the support that Moses provided for Joshua and the men. But this support was not only for the sake of winning the battle in the literal sense, but figuratively, as the Hebrew term for held up is R-U-M, not the kind of rum that comes in a bottle, even though that would probably hold some things up too. It's pronounced room, and it means to raise and to lift and to exalt. I found that when Moses held up his arms, he indeed exalted the people in a sense, because it served as power and inspiration for morale. Can you imagine while being in a fight, while going forth to accomplish a great task, you see somebody holding up their arms as if to say they are cheering you on, to support you, to say, hey, you have what it takes to do this. How encouraging and how motivating is it to know that you have support? It fuels the fire forward to be able to see that you have someone or someone in your corner. But can you imagine what it would be like to be in a fight? Or to be attempting to accomplish a great task and all of a sudden see those arms go down? Causes you to wonder, where is that support? Where is the motivation and the encouragement? And why is an event. Understand, though, that it's not just the responsibility of the supporter to motivate and encourage, because there's a level of faith that we should have in ourselves to know that we have what it takes to get the job done. There's also a level of faith that we should have in God in knowing that we have what it takes to do it. And even if we happen to have some moments where our hearts get tired and heavy and weak, and where we are weak, God is made strong. So I ask a twofold question of us, Northwood. Where's our holdup? In the sense of our support of each other to shape and shift. Not only in support of or for me, but in support of the legacy that is Northwood. Of our own willingness to hold up the work of God with all that we got. But the flip side of the question is, what's the holdup? What's preventing us from moving outside of ourselves, from stepping outside of our comfort zones, from moving beyond the familiar to bring in the change that we continuously speak of? It's definitely not impossible. It's everything but impossible, especially when we have the living God on our side and we have the power of the living God living on the inside. Especially that power of our God who's used to raising up. As God literally raised Jesus and Lazarus from death to life. And God used Ezekiel to speak to dry dead bones so that they could live. And God used Elijah to raise the Shunammite's son. And God, through Jesus, God used Jesus through the centurion to raise his soldier. And God used Jesus to raise Jairus' daughter. So God is used to raising up situations that seem grave and then turning them around for the good. And if God did it before, God absolutely can and will do it again if we're ready and willing. So I ask you, are you ready to move forward? Are we ready to put hearts and hands in as co-creators so that we can shake and shift? So that we can prevail for the sake of visible church growth and community engagement? And who knows, maybe you're Joshua in this scenario, one to develop the team, or strategies for the team, or maybe you're the chosen men and women to go to the battlefield, to engage the community. Or maybe you're Aaron and Hur, to serve as support to those in leadership, or who knows, maybe you're Moses, and you're the one to cheer everybody on. But let us know if you have any. There's somebody to support you as you support us. Us because we're in this together. Not just me and not just you, but us. And not just us by ourselves because we know that God is with us as we are co-creators. And the moves that we make or the lack thereof will help us to determine what's next. Today's bulletin quote speaks to us not just waiting for something to happen. Can you imagine what it would have been like if Moses just waited for God to show up, waited for Joshua to do something without necessarily being told? If we think about it, God never really makes a move without us. In most situations, even if it's not a tangible move that we make, there's the willingness of our hearts and the readiness of our minds. So here we are as co-creators. In a space where we can shape and shift. In a space where we can prevail and see visible church growth and engage the community. In a space where we can leave an indelible mark on the neighborhood and further fortify the legacy that's here. And if necessary, build a movement in creative and exciting ways that are going to invite people to not only come, but come and stay for a while and become a part of what it is that we are doing. Because we are in it together. We're in it to be able in the sense of support the legacy that is Northwood and no longer hold it up by way of preventing ourselves from going forward. It's in your name that we pray and give thanks and we believe it to be so. Amen. God, we give you thanks for meeting us here. We give you thanks for the songs of worship that have gone forth. We give you thanks for the opportunity to sit at the table and bring open the bread of life. A word, God, that I pray has charged us, that has recharged us, so that we as co-creators can shape and shift this community. Thank you, God, that your grace